Welcome, everybody. Oh, this is going to be a little boring talk about SAML and OAuth. And at the end, we will try to compare a little bit and find that the comparison was surprisingly not that bad. And all the flame wars going on here and there, everywhere, it's actually about the choice. And you have to really be careful what you are aiming for in your solution, and then choose the protocol. And it's not just about the protocol, it's also about the server, which will be used as IDP or whatever, SP as well. But hopefully this will little bit shed some light on both protocols, and you can decide. In 40 minutes, we cannot go really deep anywhere. So I will try to get a little overview of both of them, and then we can talk a little about comparison and what I found, the differences and security considerations. So let's start with SAML, which is older, so probably has a little preference. What is SAML? SAML security assertion markup language. I'm not going to talk about history, and I'm going to skip all the previous version and land to version 0.0, and the same for OAuth. So all the SAML and OAuth marks in the presentation will be about SAML 2.0 and the same for OAuth 2.0. So what can somebody imagine behind the security assertion markup language? We can, from one point of view, say that it's an XML-based data format for exchanging authentication and authorization information between parties. Cannot say the two parties, maybe many parties. And also, the other point of view may be that SAML defines really syntax and processing semantics about assertions and subjects in the system. SAML system entities may use also other protocols to communicate and to get some information about entities, and that can be also included in assertions. Also, what is important to say that SAML is based on XML, and it's actually a bunch of XML, like an XML message with envelopes and different things, heavily using XML namespaces. And just a little remark: if you are starting with SAML and trying to read all those documents in the specification, or probably looking for some SAML messages, make sure that you first check the namespaces SAML, SAMLP, whatever XML signature. They are usually kind of standardized, so they use the prefix still the same. And it will help you in the understanding of the whole message, and see in what part of the specification actually you should look for the semantic. The good thing about SAML is that it has pretty nice defined bindings to communication protocols. As we have first and the most important is HTTP protocol. So we have HTTP POST, HTTP redirects, then XML encoded SOAP messages as well. So here is a little list of other subspecifications which are part of the SAML 2.0, and see that there is SAML bindings which provides framework for embedding to different transport protocol messages. Then SAML profiles, which is talking about how to actually the whole communication between parties goes. And the very, very important one is the web SSO profile. It's probably the most used one. Then we have SAML metadata, which can help with some setups and ease the whole setup process. Then SAML authentication context specification, so we can actually see what is in the context of authentication information we are getting in. And SAML conformance specification as well. Useful stuff. In a SAML talk, we should recognize following actors, which probably everybody knows. It's a principal, typically user, service provider. What is service provider? That's usually our application we are trying to insert to the whole system. And then identity provider, obvious. Identity provider is the one who actually decides and do the authentication of the user. And identity provider is quite an important piece in the whole picture. And as the SAML is very good in interoperability between different solutions already on the market, so it's not very uncommon that we have identity provider which is already in place when we are coming to some company with our installation or whatever, with our service provider, or we need to insert our service provider in some already pre-existing stuff. So it is very high chance that our solution will work. Of course, some tweaking always possible and desired. Okay. So I choose just the one of the examples of the flow of information, just to explain how the thing is done. And this one comes from the basic SAML SSO use case. There are some more use cases, and we should probably examine them. Or the best way is to open specification and see. It's written very well, and I didn't say it from the beginning, but the specification came from Oasis, so it's quite a standard. So we have user agent. User agent is always something we call browser or HTTP HTTP communication of the browser. Then we have service provider and identity provider. So user types his request for service provider, and the user agent attempts to load the resource. Yeah, service provider usually for the first time cannot see any useful information from the request, and then no identity information in there. So he determines that identity provider should be used to actually give us that information. There are certain ways how service provider knows who is the identity provider, but let's just assume for now that he knows, and then authentication request message is pushed back to the user agent, and then user agent has to redirect this request to identity provider. Then comes fun part which is the both-ended arrow which says the identity provider identifies principle and methods may vary. Yeah, that's true. Here your browser got redirected to identity provider, and based on what identity provider already is set up, he can start to negotiate the authenticate the user. The easiest way, username and password, so you can be redirected to some form with username and password, authenticate there, then an identity provider we create the session and create also response message, send you back. There are also other possibilities. For example, Kerberos could be one of them. And the way how identity provider is actually storing or getting the information of identities, it's not specified in any way. It's up to what we currently have on the side of identity provider. So it's outside of the SAML specification. So here comes response message, which user agents push to service provider. And then service provider, based on the response, which could be that user like positive assertion of the user identity, it could be negative assertion, we don't know the user, or it could be positive assertion but with the not proper roles attached or no proper authorization. So service provider can decide at this point to refuse, reveal the resource, or reveal the resource and that data, and can usually establish each session with user agents, and then they can communicate. Identity and service provider?
Yes.
They may talk. Profile, or this is the basic web profile, and in different setups they can talk. But they has to establish the trust somehow between those two. So you cannot actually send anything to the service provider which will like a forged token or something, because by the SAML specification, the assertion has to be signed, and this one has actually part of the process here is to actually evaluate the signature and everything. And it's strongly recommended that the PKY in both or in the whole system has to be set up proper way, and it has to be really, really utilized. And it should be also based on certificates, and all the signatures has to be validated against it. So they kind of talk. Okay, let's leap to our other party, which is OAuth. As the name says, it's authorization framework. So usual thing here is that, oh, there is no authentication, but it is somehow possible. But it is not part of this specification. And I will talk it in a differences, so just save it. So what is OAuth? It's a authorization framework that enables third-party applications to obtain limited access to HTTP service. Could be on behalf of user, or could be on behalf of itself. I think all this is quite known from the user perspective right now. So people are using Twitter, Facebook, or Google+, something. So you know those suddenly you have new application in your mobile, and then it in mobile it's a little bit a different story, but for example in browser, and it asks you as a user to actually grant some permissions to the application to read the resources, and you are the owner of the resources. So that's the main difference between OAuth and SAML. Let's see. I slowly started to talk about actors in OAuth. So go there. As I said, resource owner, it's a user. There is a resource server. Could be imagined as a service provider in SAML. Then there is a client. It's a client application. And authorization server. Authorization server, it's equivalent of identity provider in SAML. So we so we as a users are instructing resource server that our client application is allowed to get information we have stored already on the server. So just some interested things which should be known is that there are some endpoints defined by the OAuth protocol, and we already seen it in the presentation before, the redirection, that's actually this endpoint. Then there is a token endpoint and authorization endpoint. So those are the things that used by client to obtain authorization from resource owner. This one is the used by client to exchange and to exchange authorization grant for access token. So first we got authorization grant, as I said, then access token, and the access token could be used to get the resource. And this is the client redirection endpoint in case of we are getting the response where we should be redirected. So how to obtain authorization in OAuth? There are a couple of defined ways, and we as a provider of application has to choose what is the best fit for us. OAuth distinguishes between applications in certain way. So there are trusted applications and not that trusted applications, and it all depends on how good the application is or what are the capabilities of application to store secrets or shared secrets, which are somehow necessary. So some of those things are, I think that's client credentials grant. This one is used mainly for read-only applications. So we have the authorization code grant for the web application for the web server applications in general, and this is the most frequently used according to web sources I've seen. Then we have implicit grant. All are very similar, but they define some shortcuts and a little bit different workflows in name of making it much more easier for user. For example, on your mobile, you already have set up the account on your mobile. For example, Android, so they know that you don't have to really for each application to. You are going to use in a Google. You don't have to get the each application permission to use or to read your data. Then this is one resource owner password credential. It's frequently used just for migrating already existing solutions to OAuth, and it's username and password based. at client credential grants used for client applications that want to request access to some provider on behalf of themselves. So it's this workflow is used for service applications. And finally, we can get to the protocol flow. This one is the basic one. And as I said, those may vary depending on what kind of authorization grant you are seeking. So we have our client, which usually send the authorization request to resource owner. That's the thing which asks, hey, is this application able to read your tweets or something? Then you say yes, and authorization, it always comes with some, not always, usually comes with some redirection somewhere, or it can be even implemented directly on your mobile with API. So you get the screen, and you can say, yes, I'm granting the access. So that's your part. Good thing is that it stays on the server side, and you can actually deny that access anytime. So once you decided that it's not the case anymore that you want to this client read your resources, you say no, and all the tokens which are everywhere suddenly stop working. Then you have to go to authorization server with the authorization grant and seek access token. And once your client have access token, it can be used to get the resource, and the protected resource can go back. The access token goes with each request to the resource server, and there is also one possibility to get special kind of token, which is called refresh token. So you can refresh, because the access token has usually set the, or it's very very recommended to set timeouts on the access tokens. So once the access token is not valid, you have to go through this process again. Or to speed it up, you can use refresh token, and then get your access token again working. So everybody sees that there are some important secrets which should be somehow protected, and that's why OAuth really defines and distinguishes between applications which are already accessing the resource server or authorization server. So I guess that for basic understanding, this will be somehow fine. And you see that those flows are little bit similar. We have a resource owner, one more actor here in OAuth. But let's see. So I was trying to find some differences from my point between those two protocols. And here they are. So first, which is the most remarkable one, and from this fact, actually, there are other things we should start thinking of. So SAML uses XML. No way, it's XML-based. Then OAuth might be binary or JSON. And the fact is that those tokens for SAML are much more complex than those from OAuth. Now we have communication protocol. Communication protocol in SAML is quite well defined, and all those bindings are just about to standardize the thing and make the interoperability better experience. OAuth has exclusively HTTP bindings. User, I'm not sure if this is the most important one, but probably very important one, that user identity in SAML should be actually trusted, because SAML tokens contains user identity information and it is signed. So the level of trust is much more better than here in OAuth. It is not out of the box in OAuth, but it is possible to actually do this stuff. What is the difference? Difference is that once you are going to set up something here, you have to be really careful and also be careful what you are getting for the like an identity information and how you can validate the assertion. Primary usage for both of them. I already said that it's a basically synonym for federated SSO, single sign-on. And there are three spaces: inside the company, business to business, or in cloud scenarios. Probably majority people here from Red Hat, and our famous Mojo is also on federated SSO right now, using SAML to communicate between service provider and your client. And then you also see the authentication part. It's very nice to see that you have to actually pull your token and authenticate against the IDP. Then in OAuth, it was designed for internet applications with the delegation of authorization to resources. And that says all, because it is really good in the cloud environments that everyone can actually set their own access and deny that access. That's a very important thing. From perspective of mobile devices, it is SAML 2 is possible, but it's harder to implement, and I think the mobile devices don't like the XML parsing very much. Might change, might not, I don't know. So easier to pass OAuth messages and tons of client libraries that can be used at the side of mobile device. Then we have enterprise applications, which SAML is, I think, the better fit because of interoperability. Already lots of solutions on the market and, yeah, more standardized. Usually, if you are trying to put your service provider in some already existing environment, it's not that difficult to achieve. For OAuth in the enterprise application, it is possible, and I am sure that we are going to see this more and more in the future, because the specification says that one of the use cases could be this, and all the thing can be set up. So right now we will see, I think, a little shift to this part of the universe. Let me quickly talk about security considerations in both. Also, what is very, very important here, it's message transport. SAML should use TLS or SSL, and OAuth has already mandatory those two TLS versions. And there was a change from OAuth 0.1 that actually in message confidentiality will be swapped, and the TLS will be used for OAuth too. Authentication information is part of SAML